Hello, everybody. Okay, we're back with part two. So sorry it took so long for part two to come out. Yeah, it's just been very busy, but yeah. Okay, so just one reason why the calculated percentage of oxygen in the mixture may not be accurate. Well, we're talking about this particle right here if we need to be reinformed. So yeah, we're applying heat to the copper powder. We're checking the mixture of oxygen, right? And yeah, we're just seeing how the volume of gas decreases with copper. So how can it be affected? Well, if there's a leak in the apparatus, it's going to be affected. And if the temperature differs between each of our readings, right? So if between these readings our temperature changed, that's also going to cause the calculated percentage to be different. Okay. Next up, we have question 5. I already wrote some of these because question 5 is very easy. Okay, relative charge, proton and a neutron. So proton we know is 1 over relative mass of 1. A neutron is the same, relative mass of 1. Relative charge proton, we know that it's plus 1, electron is minus 1, already labeled. And we know that a neutron, like said in its name, a neutron is neutral. So, yeah. See the meaning of the term isotopes? So, this definition is very common. I see it quite often. And you always want to start your definition with this. Atoms of the same element. It's a very easy way to start it. It gets you going. And after you say this, you'll be able to remember the rest. So, the definition is atoms of the same element with the same number of protons but a different number of neutrons. Okay? Number 3, the symbol of an atom of one isotope of magnesium is this. Give the number of protons and electrons in one atom of this isotope. Well, we know the protons is the number at the bottom, as I indicated here, so we know that's 12. Neutrons, well, to count the neutrons, we need to do the atomic mass, the mass number, which is the bigger number, the number on the top, minus our atomic number, the number on the bottom, and then we get a number, answer of 14. And then electrons, well, the electrons will always be the same as the number of protons unless there's a charge on the ion. But we know that this is a atom, meaning it's neutral, so electrons is the same as the number of protons. Okay, number 3, we have a very simple calculation of relative atomic mass. So the formula we use for atomic mass is we use the mass times the abundance, so the percentage, plus the mass times the percentage, times mass times percentage, and then we all divide that all by 100. So 24 is the mass, and this number next to the mg, that indicates its mass, mass number. So 24 times 79, 25 times 110, and plus 26 times 11, over all over 100, and we get 24.32. For our answer. Okay. Now for IV. 1 mole of magnesium has a mass of 24.32. There is a 6.022 times 10 to the 23, which we know is Avogadro's constant, atoms in 1 mole. Calculate the mass in grams of 1 mole of magnesium. Okay, so it's basically asking us, so we know that 1 mole has 24.32, and we know that we need to get per atom. Well, how many atoms in a mole? It tells us this number, Avogadro's constant. So we just put that number in 6.022, like I already wrote it here. And then if we do it correctly, we get an answer of this. And I've already written it in the terms of 4 significant figures, so make sure you know how to do that. So 4.039 times 10 to the minus 23. Okay, the equation for the reaction between magnesium and oxygen is this. Determine the maximum amount of moles of magnesium that can be produced from 0.5 moles of magnesium and 0.2 moles of oxygen. Well, from our two things, first we need to identify what the limiting reagent is. So we get this into equal coefficients, so 2mg that, so we divide this by 2, we get 2.5. And then we know that oxygen is the limiting reagent, right? Because if we get them to equal proportion, we know that oxygen is 0.2, which is less than 0.25. And then, because since we know oxygen is the limiting reagent, we know that this is what affects the mass for here, I mean the moles for here. So we just use our molar ratio, and we have 0.2, right, which is 1 to 2, because this is a coefficient for O2 is 1, coefficient for this is 2. So then there's 1 to 2 ratio, so 0.2, and then that's 0.4, you just times it by 2. Simply done. Okay. Diagram shows the electronic configuration of sodium and oxygen, and then this is about Na2O. Okay, describe the changes in electronic configuration that atoms of sodium to form the ions of sodium oxide? Oh yeah, very easy question. Pull out the text box. Okay, so it wants us to talk about ions. We know there's going to be loss and gain of electrons. So we can clearly see here that sodium is going to lose. So sodium loses one electron. And you can say this, it's quite general, but it might be nice if you want to say that there are two sodiums that lose the electrons, because this actually should be kind of, this is actually two sodiums, because we know it's Na2O, right? We know the formula is Na2O, so there's going to be two sodiums. But then this is good enough. We can just say sodium loses one electron, or we can say each of the two sodiums loses one electron, or you can say sodium atoms, probably better. And then the oxygen atom gains two electrons. Okay, there we go. That's our answer. If you're wondering how's 3 marks, we get 1 mark each for saying that the loss and gain of electrons, and we get another mark for saying that's one electron for sodium and 2 electrons for oxygen, because it's a total of 3 marks. Calculate the MR of sodium oxide using information from the periodic table. Okay. Basically, it wants us to just add the MRs of sodium, add the MRs because we add the MRs of sodium and oxygen together, so we have Na2O, right? And then, if I can remember correctly, because I don't have a periodic table on me, sodium is around 23 plus 23, because it's Na2, right? So we're having, so 2 times 23, this is a nicer way to write it, 2 times 23, because it's Na2, right? And then we have plus O, which is 16. It gives us around, should be 62. Yeah, 62. Explain why solid sodium oxide does not conduct electricity. Well, sodium oxide is a giant ionic structure. We should know that. And in this, when it's in a solid state, the ions in this giant ionic structure are not free to move, meaning it cannot transfer the flow of current. And also, even if it's fixed position, it does not have any delocalized electrons to carry charge. Okay? So again, a flame test to show that sodium oxide contains sodium ions. This should be a free mark, and if you don't know this, you need to review your flame test, because they're very important. And you should know that sodium ions form a yellow flame during a flame test, and that is your answer. Okay, when sodium oxide is heated, it reacts to form sodium metal and sodium peroxide. Okay, complete the equation for this reaction. Let's have a look. So Na2O forms, we know it's going to form sodium metal and sodium peroxide, so let's just fill that in first. So Na plus Na2O2. Okay, so that's it. But we know this isn't balanced, right? We can just assume it's not balanced, because why would they give us such a free question like that? So we know it's not balanced. So let's figure out how to balance it. So let's count on each side what we have. So let me go in drawing. Okay, so Na, and then O. Okay, left side for Na's, we have two Na's, okay? Right side, let's see, Na and A2, so that's three Na's. Left side, we have one O, right side, we have two O's, so this isn't right. Yeah, there's a problem, because we're not having the right amount of Na's. So how can we get from, let's try and figure the O first, because the O is easier to solve. So how can we get from one O on the left to two O's on the right? We just add a two here. So that gives us two Na, Na2O, from which that. And because of that, we need to adjust these as well, because this now becomes 4, right? So how do we get from 3 Na here on the right side to 4? Well, we can just add a 2 here. So 2 Na2O forms 2 Na plus Na2O2. That is our final answer. Okay, this question is about soluble and insoluble compounds. A precipitate is formed in a insoluble compound when solutions of soluble compounds react after mixing. So basically what we're looking for is we're looking for something that forms an insoluble compound. Let's look at these. So tube 1, so copper sulfate and calcium chloride. So what would that form? That would form copper chloride and calcium sulfate, right? So what do we know about copper chloride calcium sulfate? Well, we know that if we remember our solubility rules, and this part is all theory actually, so it's all, we're lucky it's only one mark because it's a pretty difficult theory. This is probably the hardest part of IGCSE. So if you struggle remembering this, I just recommend you try and study it because these are solubility rules. They're quite complicated, but yeah, I just recommend you try your best to remember them. So basically, we should know that if we're going to get calcium sulfate form, that's going to be insoluble, right? That's going to form precipitate. So precipitate tick. Okay, let's check two. It's going to form magnesium sulfate and potassium nitrate. But well, we know for a fact easily potassium nitrate is definitely soluble. And we actually, we also know that magnesium is one of the sulfates that is also soluble. So this forms no insoluble products. So this is not going to be. So tube two is going to form no precipitate. Okay. And tube three, we're going to form sodium sulfate and copper carbonate. And immediately you should be able to tell that copper two carbonate, that will definitely form precipitate because it's insoluble, so precipitate formed. So tube one and three, so that gives us C. If you do not understand my explanation just then, please review your solubility rules. Okay, student mixes solutions contain equal amounts in moles of silver nitrate and copper chloride. The equation for the reaction is that, state the color of precipitate of silver chloride, it's white. Just one second, theory, silver chloride, white. Okay, this is a crystallization, yeah, okay. There are, these questions appear all the time, they're all kind of the same. So there's basically steps you want to go, and I won't be very detailed because you have to construct your answer in the way that you deem fit, but I'll give you the general things you want to say. So first of all, when you get a crystallization, read it to make sure you're looking at the right thing. So it wants pure dry crystals of sodium nitrate, yes, okay, and we need pure dry crystal sodium nitrate, okay, and that's what they react to. So how are we going to do it? First of all, filter the solution, okay, because we want to filter out precipitate, okay, then boil, because we want to boil off some of the water, right, to evaporate some of the water. Note that boiling won't get all of the water out because there will still be water needed when it crystallizes, okay, so then leave to cool so that crystals can form. Then it should be something like remove excess liquid, filter again. You can say filter again or remove excess liquid to obtain crystals. And then finally, important part, very easy to remember, dry crystals. Okay. And then usually you have to state a method of drying the crystals. The most common one I've seen, and a nice one, is to say, oh wow, is to say in a warm oven. That's what I like to say. So once again, this is just the steps. Any thing you fail to understand here, I recommend you review the theory because it'll make more sense once you understand the theory. But yeah, this is just the general steps you want to say. If you check all these marks off, you'll get 5 marks very easily. Given advantage of mixing solutions containing equal amounts of silver nitrate and sodium chloride. Oh, this is very easy. Okay, so why do we want equal amounts in moles? Well, to ensure all the silver nitrate and sodium chloride has reacted. Why? Well, we can see from here, this equation is 1:1:1 ratio. So putting the same moles will mean that once one thing is used up, the other thing will be used up as well. So there'll be no limiting reaction. So once the whole thing has once one thing has reacted, everything will have reacted. So you're not wasting anything. You're ensuring the highest possible yield, that kind of thing. Okay, this is organic chemistry questions. Some people find it quite hard, but it's not too bad. So let's go. Table show structures of 6 organic compounds. Give the letter of compound not shown as a displayed formula. Well, this is very easy. I mean, even if you don't know what a state display formula is, which you should, you can just see which one is the odd one on. And we can see that all of them are showing all the bonds between the carbon and hydrogen, except for A. A has a CH3 instead of showing the actual formula. So we can know that A is that. So it's not showing this display formula because of the CH3. Okay. Nitro is a saturated compound with a general formula CnH2n. And if you don't understand CnH2n, once again, review the theory, but basically means that there's double the amount of hydrogens to carbon. So we can just count that, okay? And you can count all of them, but I will tell you that immediately from deduction, we know we can remove the, all the double bonds, a double bonded ones to count them, because it says saturated compound, right? And when you say saturated, it means there's no double bonds in the hydrocarbon. So remove B, remove E, you don't have to look at them. For D, we can count 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12. So, oh, wait, 1, 2, 3, 4, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So it's 10. So 10, and that's like, we know that's 4 times 2 is 8, so that's wrong. F, we know that 1 times 2 is not 4, there's 4 here. So then 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. So C is 5 carbons to 10 hydrogens, 1 to 2, and we know that the answer is C. Name compound E. Well, let's have a look at E. We can see it's 3 carbons, okay? And we know it's an alkene because there's one double bond. And 3 carbon alkene, we should know that it's called a propene. A, explain why compound A and compound D are isomers. Okay, A and D, well, why are they isomers? Well, they, even though compound A, we can't really see its display formula, we know that they have the same molecular formula, right? For CH4, yeah. I mean C4H10, so yeah, we know the same display formula, same molecular formula. However, different displayed formula. That's basically the definition of isomer. Same molecular formula, but different display formula, okay? Compound F reacts with bromine, presence of ultraviolet radiation. Complete the reaction for the equation reaction. So methane plus Br2 forms, and then it wants to tell us what the rest is. Well, we should know this. It's gonna give us CH3Br. Plus HER. That's one that you should know, one equation that you should know by memory. Yeah, so CH3Br plus HBr. Gave the name for this type of reaction. Well, this is a substitution reaction. Substitution, okay? Substitution reaction. Now, another compound. G has this percentage composition by mass, okay? Is carbon is 37.8, hydrogen 6.3, chlorine 55.9, and what does it want? Wants to give us the empirical formula. Interesting question, very interesting question. Okay, first thing first, empirical formula of questions. We're gonna do 37.8, which is the amount they gave us for percentage, and divide that by the MR of carbon, okay? And then we repeat this for everything else. So 6.3 divided by the MR for hydrogen, okay? And then 55.9 divided by the MR for chlorine, which I believe is 35.5, okay? And we do all of those, right? And we get something like 3.15. 6.3 is what we'll get, and then the last one should be something like 1.57. Okay, so we get those three values, and now we look for the smallest value here, okay, which is 1.57. So we see 1.57, so we take that and we divide everything by 1.57. So divide 3.15 by 1.57, 6.3 by 1.57, and 1.57 by 1.57. That gives us a ratio of 2 to 4 to 1, because 1.57 divided by 1.57 is 1, and this one is divided by 6.3 is 4, divided by this is 2, right? And this, it's not going to be perfect, right? As you can tell, it's not going to divide perfectly, but if it's close enough, you just round to the whole number that's closest, okay? And now, it has to be very close though, so if it's like just moderately close, you can do that. It's a different way of doing it. And now you get the 2 to 4 to 1 ratio, and after you got this, you already have the ratio, so you can already prove that the empirical formula is C2H4 and Cl. The MR of G is 127. Determine the molecular formula of G. And is G this? Yes, G is that. Okay. So basically, to get the molecular formula, we just need to find the ratio of the MR, right? The MR divided by the MR of this empirical formula. So we need to do 24, which is 12 times 2. 12 times 2 plus 4 plus 35.5. And then it's 28, and then gets to around 63.5, I think. 63.5. Okay. And then so we get 63.5 as our value of this, of adding these together, right? And divide that by what the actual MR is, which is that, right? And then we get a factor of, we can very easily tell, it's going to give us 2. So what does that mean? That means we have to just have to double everything in the previous one. So it's C4H8Cl2. Done. Very easily done. Okay. Now, just if this doesn't make sense to you, remember the empirical formula is the lowest ratio, right? So this and this is the same, but this is just a smaller ratio. As soon as you use this apparatus to investigate the reactive reaction between calcium carbonate chips and dilute hydrochloric acid, every 20 seconds, the student records reading on a balance. Explain why the cotton wool plug increases the accuracy of the student's results. Okay, it's pretty simple, practical. You can all understand what's happening here. So what is the reason? Well, this reaction is causing like a reaction, right? So there's going to be bubbling. There's going to be a lot of fizzing. So there's a chance the acid's going to splash out, right? So to prevent any HCl from splashing out, from exiting the conical flask. Okay. In the same sense, you can also say so that only the CO2 gas is leaving the apparatus, right? Leaving the conical flask. Okay. And for another mark, we could probably say something like how this makes it more accurate, because we've said that the HCl is preventing leaving the flask, but we're not explaining why it's making it more accurate, right? So what is preventing the HCl leaving the flask do? Well, it means that the decrease in mass is closer to the actual value, okay? And yeah. Because basically, we only want carbon dioxide to leave the flask. We don't want any of the acid or anything else to leave the flask, because that's going to change our answer. It's going to be a variable that we're not investigating, and it's going to change our results, make the mass depreciate or at a different rate than it's supposed to be. Okay. So complete the equation. So we have this equation here, and it wants us to tell us state symbols. Okay. So pretty easily, we know that CaCO3. We can see it's chips, and what are chips? Well, I had some months ago, they're solid. Then the 2HCl, well, when we have acids, we already know that's dilute, and when we have acids, we know they're going to be aqueous, right? Then we have H2O, H2O is liquid. Yeah, it's pretty easy to figure out. And CO2, yeah, well, gas, okay? Student uses the balance readings to find the decrease in mass of the flask and its contents. These are results. Give a reason why there's some calcium carbonates remaining in the flask when the reaction stops. Well, why? Well, the HCl has all reacted. Right? There's no more HCl. It can't react. Okay? So how soon do we know the reaction has stopped? The decrease in mass stops and stays the same. Okay? Yeah. Easily done. Use the graph to determine the amount of moles of carbon dioxide produced during the reaction. Okay. So this is decrease in mass as a result of, yeah. And then once the breakdown. Okay. So let's take the peak when it stops decreasing. Let's see. That's just a bit under something like here. I'd say that's 0.98, right? So 0.98 is the basically the mass. And then we want to get the amount in moles, and they give us the MR, so divided by 44. So yeah, so, and then we get a value of 0.022. The student repeats the investigation by downloading the original hydrochloric acid. The student then determines the initial rate of reaction and different percentage concentrations of the original hydrochloric acid. The graph shows the results. Okay. Okay, so they just did percentage concentration of the original, and they've seen that at the highest concentration of the original, which is basically the 100%, just means this is the original value, right? And then they just diluted it to different extents. So this is 80%, right? So it's getting different proportions of it. And basically saying that at the highest percentage concentration, it's giving us the highest initial rate of reaction. So describe the relationship between the initial rate of reaction and percentage concentration, okay? So what can we say? So we can say the rate of reaction increases as the percentage concentration increases, okay? And we can say this is a direct proportion. Say it's directly proportional, okay? Very simply done. Say it's like positive correlation is directly proportional. We can see a straight line. So yeah. Explain why changing the concentration of hydrochloric acid has an effect on the initial rate of reaction. Well, why? Well, higher concentration means larger number of particles per unit volume, right? So in the same space, larger amount of particles. So more frequent successful collisions leading to reaction. Done. Okay, the question is to do with covalent bonds. Draw a double crosstie gap to show outer shell and a molecule of N2. Well, if you're doing this just not off knowledge, it would be kind of hard, I guess, because N2 is quite a kind of complicated. But yeah, I mean, you should pretty much know that nitrogen is a triple bonded diatom when it's an N2. So what it's going to look like is this: XO, XO, XO. Okay, and yeah, I recommend you memorize this. Actually, not too hard to memorize, and it'll save you a lot of time, because a lot of people struggle with figuring out how nitrogen is bonded, because it's a triple bond. So this is what it looks like, okay? Describe the force of attraction in a covalent bond. A very simple question, and it's just a theory. So the attraction between the shared pair of electrons, I spelled shared wrong, shared pair of electrons, to the oppositely charged nuclei. Okay? Remember to say nuclei, by the way. Saying nucleus, right? That's wrong, because there's two nuclei. Okay? It's oppositely charged nuclei. The diagram shows three structures of carbon. Name structure A. Well, we can see structure A. We know what it is. Diamond. Okay? Yeah, because of that tetrahedral structure, that super characteristic of diamond, we should just know that. Okay, graphene and C60 fullerene are contain covalent bonds but have different structures. Explain why C60 fullerene, the buckyball, has much lower melting point than graphite. Okay, refer to structure and modeling in your answer. Okay, this is going to be kind of a bullet point answer because it's quite simple. Okay. Graphite is a giant covalent structure, whereas I'm going to call it buckyball because it's easier, but I'm referring to C60 fullerene, whereas the buckyball is a simple molecular structure. Okay, so in the giant covalent, right, covalent, strong covalent bonds need to be overcome to melt, so it has a high melting point, okay, in comparison, basically seeing that, yeah. And then buckyball has weak intermolecular forces of attraction, which are overcome more easily. Okay. So then we can just say there's more energy needed to break the covalent bonds than the weak intermolecular forces in the buckyball. Nice and done. Student uses apparatus to heat crystals of hydrated zinc sulfate and collect the liquid produced. Okay, colorless liquid. Describe a chemical test that shows that to show the colorless liquid contains water. Ah, oh my gosh. Okay, well, the test for water we should know is anhydrous copper sulfate. Okay. And then when you add it to the water, if water is present, okay, it turns from white to blue. Okay, describe a physical test to show the colorless liquid is pure water. We just did a chemical test, now a physical test. Well, physical, we know it has to do with melting points, 1 points, that kind of stuff. So what we know, we should know that physical test, measure boiling point. Okay, and if it's pure water, it should be 100 degrees Celsius. There. Equation for decomposition of zinc hydrogen zinc sulfate is that reaches masses. Calculate the maximum volume of pure water that could be produced. Give your answer to one decimal place. So this is just crystallization reaction. It wants us to get that. Okay. So let's get our textbooks out. Okay. So mass of hydrogen zinc sulfate. So this is the mass of the boiling tube is 41.64. And we have the mass of the boiling tube plus the hydrogen zinc sulfate, which is this. So first let's get the mass of hydrogen zinc sulfate. So it's gonna be 54.46 minus 41.64. And that's gonna give us something around 12.82. And from 12.82, okay, that we know that's our mass. And now how do we get the moles? Well, we do mass over MR. So we just get the MR of hydrated zinc sulfate, and we can see it's 287, so we divide it by 287, right? That's our number of moles. So now that we've got a number of moles, we get 0.0447 moles, okay? So now we have moles of hydrated zinc sulfate, which is here. We have the moles of here. But what do we do now? Well, now that we have moles of this, right, we need to get the moles of H2O, okay? So how do we get moles of H2O? We account for the molar ratio. So we see that this, right, we can look at the coefficients, we see this, even though there's nothing, this is 1, right? And it's a 1 to 7. So 1 to 7 ratio, right? So what do? We times what we have here by 7. So we times by 7, and that gives us a value of around 0.313 moles of H2O. Okay, now all we have to do is make this moles of H2O into mass of H2O by doing moles times MR, right? So 0.313 times 18, and that gives us 5.63 grams of H2O. Okay, and now it wants us to find the maximum volume of pure water in cm cubed that could be produced. Well, we should know that 5.63 grams, we can directly relate that to 5.63 centimeters cubed, because grams centimeters cubed, they are the same conversion, right? And it wants it to one decimal place. So 5.63, that becomes 5.6, okay? And basically, we have just calculated the volume, even though we just calculated the grams, that's the same as centimeters cubed, right? So remember that, grams centimeters cubed, you can convert them like interchangeably, because the formulas are the same. So 5.6 centimeters cubed, that is our final answer. Okay, next up. In the experiment, using a different mass of hydrogen zinc sulfate, the maximum volume of pure water is 8.5. The student collected the pure water and calculated the percentage yield to be 20.3%. Calculating the volume of pure water that could be collected. So 20.3% is the percentage yield. And we know that 8.5 cm cubed is produced, right? So we need to get 20.3% of 8.5, right? How do we do that? We just can do something simple as this. So 8.5 times 20.3 over 100. And we get sitting around like 1.7, that's our answer. 1.72, 1.73, but we'll just leave it at 1.7 because that's fine. Explain an improvement to the apparatus that would increase the percentage yield of pure water. So how can we improve percentage yield? Well, very simply done. Stand the measuring cylinder in a beaker of ice to condense the gas faster. Okay, or you can use like something like a Liebig condenser, nothing you can use. And then we can also say that this means that less H2O gas is lost, less water vapor is lost. And there we go. Everything done, 110 marks. Wow, that was long. I'm very sorry it took so long for this thing to come out. I have IB exams very soon. End of year.